Hi again, YouTube land. You'll see that by the lovely foliage behind me that I have returned to the calmer, more serene space of the den where the philosophers hang out for this episode of the End Times. We are now going on to chapter 4 of Thanquol. I have with me in the other side of the den, I have Mr. Vince Venturella.
Hello, everybody.
Yeah. Who has named himself the warlord of Clan Awesomex. Is that what it's called?
Yeah, absolutely. You just got to add X's and Y's to everything. That's how you get Skaven names. It's a really easy secret.
Yes. And I'm over here at my end in the den operating the far squeaker so that we can converse with the world. A great piece of Skaven technology. Unfortunately, though, for this episode, we are minus one of our philosophers. Keith has, being a Lizardmen compatriot that he is and a sympathizer with them, I'm afraid that he may have submitted finally to the contagions of clan pestilence that's going all over on Lustria. And we're going to talk about that a little bit later on. But for this particular episode in Chapter 4, we are going to turn our attentions away from the dwarfs who the Skaven were harassing for the last couple of chapters. And I'm going to turn it to the Empire again. And the poor men are they're going to receive the blunting of the Skaven attacks. So I'm going to turn it to you at this point, Vince, seeing as you are a great Skaven sympathizer, and let us know what these ratlings are up to in the Empire.
Absolutely. Well, first off, sympathizer, I don't know. I just support the winners in this book. That's all I would say. We turn back to the Skaven and the Empire, and the first thing I want to note is what it actually calls out right at the beginning of this chapter, where it says, the Skaven attacks upon the Empire began at the same time that Clan Pestilence launched their assault upon Lustria. And this is good to note, because obviously it tells us that basically Chapter 4 of this book is happening about the same time as Chapter 1. The timing of this book is interesting because it doesn't read straight through. So we get some more times here, a little more timestamps. It talks about Reichland and these other places that have been besieged or sacked that we've read about in earlier stories in Nagash and in Glotkin. And when we pick up with the Skaven here, we finally pick up with the book's namesake, which is Thanquol. And Thanquol is, he's not doing great at the start of the chapter, to put it simply. He is maybe the lowest we've seen him since he's kind of been introduced. He's basically, obviously, he is a Greyseer. And as we know from the early part, the Greyseers have fallen quite low from their high perch in Skaven society. And Thanquol has become the whipping boy sort of period and is now being used as a scapegoat for the failures of this operation around Nuln, even though he isn't there actually part of the time. And there's a nice little section where he talks about the nature of being a scapegoat and mentions that you always pick somebody low and fairly worthless and not dangerous to be a scapegoat. And the fact that he is now one is incredibly insulting to him, because that means that that's what someone thinks of him. And that is just unacceptable.
Now, have you ever read any of the Thanquol novels that the Black Library have done?
I have not. I understand that they don't go well for Thanquol often. He's like the Cobra Commander of the Skaven.
Yeah. I mean, exactly what we kind of get into here is it's absolutely true that he's on the opposite end of where he usually stands. Just to maybe flesh this out a little bit, because he is the title character. Thanquol in his written books, whether that be in a Felix and Gotrek novel, or a couple of the others that I can't recall the title of right now, he is the schemer. He is a fantastic schemer, and he's always got grand plans that are well above his station, which is a great example of the Skaven nature, that there's nothing beyond him. But every single time, it degrades to failure because of somebody else. Always, always somebody else. Right? And inevitably it does degrade to failure, and he never achieves his grand goals. You kind of think that maybe if the guy set his sights a little bit lower, he'd feel better about things, but no.
Well, then he wouldn't be a Skaven, though.
Yeah. And I guess regardless of that, he carries on undaunted and comes up with a brand new fresh scheme right away anyhow. So he's good at that.
Look, all I'm saying is the Skaven who set his dreams low invented the Doom Flayer. The Skaven who set his dreams high invented the Doom Wheel. And I think we see which one of those get played more. So, you know, that's, you got to aim high. That's what it is. Yeah, so Thanquol isn't doing too great, and he's being used as a sort of scapegoat. And what's worse is he gets a messenger from one of the clans, from Clan Skyre, from a, as he calls them, a techno-tinkerer, which I particularly like as a nice insult to the warp engineers, who takes away his bone ripper for repair and upgrades, which he finds unnerving because now he's bodyguardless and he's very paranoid, as all good rats should be. And he basically, he just gets put on like some busy work and things like that. And until finally sort of, you know, he comes back to Nuln and he gets blamed for another failure. And he knows that if he reports another failure, it's going to be it. That's going to be enough with them. And so he's got to buy some time. Like he has to report back into Skaven Blight, but he's got to buy time. So he gets on the Far Squeaker, which is a series of tubes, apparently, much like the internet. And he does the phone trick. I can't, like, this is one of the funniest moments in the entire End Times to me. If you've ever had a cell phone call with somebody you really didn't want to talk to, and you went, oh, it's breaking, I can't, he does that. He does the it's breaking up trick. Yeah, and then he goes Han Solo and smashes the device and says more in conversation anyways.
Yeah, and to follow that up, I thought the extra fun thing was when hearing the commotion going on in the private Far Squeaker room, a few engineers come rushing in to see what goes on, and immediately Thanquol just turns on them and starts berating them for making such a shoddy device.
Exactly. Just turns it around. It's like, why'd you build this crap? This is terrible. And just storms away. Like, and of course he knows it'll all be, you know, found out. But he knows that he's got little time and it's time to make a big play. So he kind of marches off and we kind of lose him for a little while. He's gone. And then there's this war council going on because there are four lesser clans that are all basically in charge of the Nuln attack, who have had absolutely no success. Because they keep fighting each other more than they actually fight the humans. Like the last fight that was the last sort of quote unquote invasion that happened, two of the clans surfaced at the same time, saw each other, fought each other. The humans just came out and sort of stumbled upon them and were like, what the heck? And then they both had to retreat and left a bunch of Skaven dead bodies around, which of course is a big no-no in Skaven Empire land. They're not allowed to leave any sign of themselves so they can keep being a myth. And as they're all having this discussion, the doors of the War Council get battered open, and Thanquol comes in with his new bodyguard. And his new bodyguard is a much upgraded Bone Ripper, the huge four-armed monstrosity, bigger than sort of any monstrosity they'd seen. Even they say that he's even bigger than Grand Packmaster Manxrot, which is, you know, a pretty big thing. He's mutated himself pretty far out there. And Thanquol walks in and in short order takes control. And the way he takes control is by saying, I'm in charge now. We're going with my plan. Anybody who's got a problem with it, you can deal with me. And the guy who had been in control, which was Scribbled, which is the guy who's been screwing everything up, says, wait a minute, who put you in charge? What's here? Or you know, what's going on? And then into the room floods sort of the darkness and the power that is the Vermin Lord, and the Vermin Lord's just sort of presence is like justifies Thankful's leadership as he snuffs out the lightning that's and warp magic that is coalescing into Scribble to warp energy condenser. Just snuffs out that weak sauce with some real magic, and Thankful basically says, "Well, any other questions?" and takes control.
There you go. Yeah, so we got to remember that at the end of our last chapter, actually, we revealed that Thanquol had himself a Vermin Lord, much like all the other friends are getting their vermin lords. Apparently Skribalta does not get a vermin lord though, because of his massive failures there in Nome. Poor guy. Okay, but let's switch gears then and go to the surface world while these Skaven are sorting themselves out. So picking up from a point that you just made a moment ago about how the last invasion ended up in just Skaven fighting on Skaven and a whole bunch of militia being gathered into the streets to see what the disturbance was, but they really just spent all their time just watching these little rat men beat up on one another. And at this point, even though the Skaven been around for ages, and this is by far not the first invasion of Nome by Skaven, all the humans still want to not believe in Skaven. You know, it's one of those situations where, you know, it's just chaos mutated rats or some crazy old man who had been out too deep into his cups has noticed some things and told the stories, or wives are telling their children to fear these mangy things in the streets and the sewers. So this really is a big deal. It's the first time that it's insurmountable evidence that the Skaven exist, yet still there's people in the higher camps that still don't want to believe it. And thus brings in one of our characters, and he is called Captain Dreschler. He's responsible for a lot of the patrolling of the streets within Nome and is part of the Black Tower Guard, they're called. So seeing all this firsthand himself, he tries to convince Emanuela von Liebwitz, who is the matriarch of Nome, of their existence. And he really starts to investigate this a little bit deeper and kind of puts a number of things together. And one of those things is that he finds it suspicious that all of this activity seems to be going on around the foundry district of Nome. And of course, Nome is the pinnacle of engineering in all of the empire, and maybe in all of the world itself when it comes to steam power engineering and black powder and that sort of thing. So that's what Nome is most famous for. Anyway, what Dreschler does here is being not able to convince the higher-ups that an invasion is imminent, he takes it upon himself to start organizing patrols and reinforcing them not only on the surface around the foundry, but also sending more down into the sewers as well. So he does that with nightly efforts and sends in extra patrols to try to discover things, but in all respects is still coming up empty. So he kind of loses his steam in being able to prove that something is imminent. The only guy that he really lends his ear to that's willing to believe him is this amber wizard called Bernd Aberwald. And he shares his concerns about the Skaven, but at that point it really doesn't go much of anywhere. It just suffice to say that the humans are on alert now, and they're at least aware that something bad is going to happen. So that's maybe where I turn it back to you, my Skaven friend, to let us know what, now that Thanquol's in charge, what he has put in motion.
Yes, so we pick up with our, first things first, Thanquol sort of works with Skribalt to figure out why everything's been going wrong. And I mean works with in the same way that mob bosses usually say, go take care of somebody. Like, he doesn't kill him, but, you know, it's pretty evident that he has to be aggressive with Skribalt to get the information out. And basically what he learns is that this whole thing is really directly Skribalt. He's been setting the warlord clans against each other. He's been... the Skribalt's been tipping off the humans, basically, so they show up in the right places at the right time to actually prevent anything from really happening. And the whole goal was to steal a bunch of black powder in vast quantities. They also needed a working steam engine. But unfortunately, Skribalt hadn't really done any of these things yet. And so in this sort of, and that's why they haven't sort of overrun the city, because they feel it would be too costly in sort of time and bodies. And besides, in that, they would probably destroy all the things they needed to collect. So Thanquol, basically, he goes back to what he's been doing, which is sort of chewing a lot of warpstone. He's always been a warpstone addict, but now he's really hitting the sauce hard, because that's what lets him communicate with his vermin lord directly as he goes into these sort of warpstone-fueled trips. And so basically he kind of formulates a plan. And he very quickly, after he talks to the vermin lord and, you know, has this great insight, he calls up the Eshin people he has, and he gets all the gutter runners together, and boom, out in the streets, you've got black clad gutter runners just, you know, running around doing something. You don't really get to see what at this exact point in the story, but they're clearly sneaking about the edges of the city at night, doing something, not attacking, not killing yet. But they're just sort of, they're all moving to very specific positions, and they just kind of set up something very large, which we'll learn about exactly what they do whack a few people who get in their way. But on the whole, they're not out there on like a kill mission. I mean, they're not softballing it, but as we learn when we run into one of the sewer patrols that unfortunately ran afoul of the gutter runners. But for the most part, they're quiet and they're just setting up their plan.
Yeah. So the one thing that I guess that we do reveal here is that even though Thanquol was around Nome, he never knew what the ultimate goal was, and that galled him as well. So once he squeezed this out of Scribbleton and understood what the real goal was, then he felt a lot better about himself. Now, let's go back to the surface world again for a second. So Dreschler has his patrols down in the sewers, and there's this little sidebar about one particular crew who is mulling their way around in the sewers at night, complaining about it, of course, because it's a terrible bitch of a job. And they hear scurrying, they think they see things, etc., just like the Skaven would like them to be in that position. But eventually they do come across another patrol of theirs, of their comrades, who is just slaughtered and they're face down in the sewers. And they go, oh crap, this is bad news. We better get up and tell the captain. What they do discover, though, is effectively late in the whole operation, one of the patrols discovers this very odd-looking device, which they then bring to Captain Dreschler, and he is befuddled by it, but he is also convinced that it must be a Skaven device because it doesn't look like anything that humans would do. So he comes upon himself that he needs to go and chat with somebody who he can rely on and he can trust and that would be knowledgeable about this. So he bumps his way to the foundry yards and encounters an engineer near the name of Gunther Maybach, who at the exact moment that Drexler arrives upon him is tinkering away at a steam tank, which he calls Deliverance. And this is the one working engine that goes on in Nome. And let's remember here for a second, just for a key moment, that one of the goals of the Skaven was to steal a mountain worth of black powder and a working steam engine. So that's the foreboding about Deliverance here. So anyway, as they're having a talk and Dreschler presents this item to him, Maybach is really, he is obviously intrigued. He examines the device, and it occurs to him that it must be a bomb. And it was found in the nearby docks near the workshops. This is one passage here that I kind of want to read out because it's how he describes it. And he says, the saboteurs seemed to have an unusual grasp of bomb making. Parts of the build were ingenious, while other bits looked like the handiwork of disinterested children. Captain Dreschler, of course, had no expertise with munitions, but the ramshackle designs of the bomb had a familiar aspect. Looked very much like the strange devices that he'd seen the ratmen using, and he quickly explained his growing fears to Maybach. Now, One little Skaveny thing that's going on here in the meantime is actually on the munitions yard in some kind of storage shed. There is a group of night runners that are clutched and huddled around there who are actually spying on these two as they're examining the device. And as the two men are tinkering around with it, the Skaven, through their little far-seeing devices, actually see them set it off, not to the detonation point, but set it off so that it starts to whir and twirl, and the drill that's on there springs into life. And they can actually see now, as the two men watch this thing do its thing, as it sort of jumps around for a little bit, and then it noses downwards and starts drilling its way through the flagstones and into the ground down below. So at this point, the Skaven who are watching are like, oh, well, I guess the jig is up. The humans know what we're doing now. So let's get out of here and go to the staging area.
I just want to put a pin on something real quick there. Those night runners who are in there, there's actually an engineer, like it's a warlock engineer at the head of those night runners who's watching. And he isn't just like peering out through a crack in that. He's using his spotter scope, and what he says is, if I adjust certain dials and wheels, not only can it see through the wood and the slats, but he can see through stone with it. So to be clear, this warlock engineer has an X-ray telescope, just like he has a Superman vision telescope he's using to spy on this scene. I mean, is there any question of the preeminence of Skaven amongst this world? I don't see the Empire making X-ray telescopes, I'm just saying, so...
No, I'm on board with you in that way. Like, I think with the marvels of Skaven technology are unparalleled. Like, I mean, let's think of the things that we've talked about just to pause and have a little time out, and we'll regale the Skaven with their brilliance for just a second. So we have them making a device currently, which is going to blow up the moon. Super good. They have in the past made a doom wheel, which, as you alluded to, is one of the favorite pieces of engineering. Powered by rats and electricity. And they're the ones that have really harnessed that kind of electricity power. We had, in Chapter 1, remember, we had a similar device held by, I can't remember the guy's name, but it was essentially, it cut through the mists so that they could see through the mists at a far, right, outside of that Lizardmen city. They have this far squeaker device, which allows them to, you know, communicate over miles and miles of distance. You know, so they created the internet in the Warhammer world.
Yep. At the very least, the telephone.
Yeah. And now we see X-ray vision, right?
Absolutely.
Marvel. Yeah, what else you got?
They are uniquely brilliant. Now, what it doesn't tell you is that the spotter scope gives off enough radiation to cause cancer within like 3 years of using it. So, I mean, it's good. There are downsides to Skaven technology, but I'm just saying they work. That's what's important.
Yeah. That's the price you pay for advancement.
That's right. You know? Yeah, not a lot of safety regulations or extra tests going on in Skaven technology world.
Yeah. So all these events that we've just talked about here is happen at the exact moment when the sun is about to set. And as it's setting on Nome, we hear the first of this great big bell tolling across the city. And... anybody that's familiar with Skaven understand the foreboding of the big bell strike. So it's heating up right here. Vince, let us know what's happening now.
Absolutely. So night sets and the bell tolls, and the bell tolls doom, which I like. Like that's the sound of the ringing of the bell, just the word doom, really loud. And the first thing that happens is the Skaven secret weapon invades, and that is the rats that live in the sewers of Nuln. Millions and millions of rats flood up from beneath the sewers and just start infesting the city. And at first, it's kind of like a, you know, what it's annoying, but they're just rats. And it's only when they become literally a carpet and all of a sudden they realize, wait a minute, this isn't just some rats. This is the wall, a swarm, an unstoppable horde of rats that just sweeps forward. And people who had been moments before trying to like, ha-ha, stomp at them to crush them are overtaken and consumed by the swarm. So people flee, and then out comes the first of the assaults. So this is led by Trickstab. Trickstab is a grand warlord in a clan Vertkin, V-R-R, in clan needs to buy a vowel because that is not a word. And basically he gets propped up, like he was sort of given this honor to lead this very important mission and this kind of thing, you know, and so all of the forces that try to rally up to the northern part of the city where Trickstab is invading. But unfortunately, that's all kind of a bit of a diversion. And you know, the Nuln is famous for not only its weaponry, but as you hear the Skaven mention earlier, it's really good at mobilizing its army. Like Nuln gets attacked pretty frequently because it has the riches of the empire, and the people who defend it are not greenhorns. Like these are expert soldiers who have seen a lot of combat, and when it's time to go to war, they go to war fast and ready. And unfortunately, the Grand Marshal, which is here, so he's a knight commander, Grand Marshal Erkstein, he rallies up, and very quickly the Skaven have just a really tough fight on their hands to the point where, you know, their invasion's going nowhere. Unfortunately for Trickstab, that was the whole point. As the bell tolls the second time and the forces begin to clash, boom. Boom goes the dynamite. And 100 bombs explode of these drill bombs that had surrounded the sort of southeastern quadrant of the city, basically where the foundry and the heavy industrial ironworks were. They boom, 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 blow up in a circle, and the entire industrial section of Nuln falls down into the earth, effectively netting the Skaven everything they wanted, or the original point at least, all at once, as the whole everything falls down into the ground. It just boom, giant sinkhole, and all the guns and cannons and powder and everything that wasn't that was in the foundry is now in the Skaven's under empire, basically.
Yeah, so there's no understating what had just gone on here. So to summarize it back up, and what they kind of alluded to earlier in the chapter is that all these gutter runners went around and planted these bombs. And they were set on a timer so that they would all go off at the same time and start drilling down into the surface. And as you said, it just all slips away. And you have a bunch of stunned factory workers at the bottom of this as it slipped down, you know, a couple hundred yards, I guess. I don't know if they ever specify how far it actually drops. But as the dust sort of settles and clears, and these men who have survived the drop pick themselves up, they find themselves being stared back at by hundreds and hundreds of pairs of red beady eyes out of the darkness, who are there to stab them to death and steal all their loot.
Absolutely. And that then launches the real plan. The real battle sort of then happens as the entire ironworks of Nuln has now been torn away. Then we get the beginning of sort of the real fight. Because as we said, Trickstab was just a diversion.
Yeah, so Trickstab find himself going up the Grand Strasse, and he must have been given the orders to take the palace, right? Because that's the direction that goes up the Grand Strasse through the square and eventually to the palace, where Emanuela von Liebwitz sits on her cushioned chairs and hosts all her dinner parties and pretends that Skaven don't exist. That's her role in society. In fact, I wonder, just as a side note here, I wonder how much I remember about her history. I think that she was the elector of Solland. And Solland is an old province that doesn't exist anymore. And they lost their runefang to Gorbat Ironclaw. And I think that's why she sort of scurried away to Nuln and set up shop there. So she's kind of a deposed elector of a province that doesn't exist any longer. Does that ring true to you, or do you know anything about that?
I don't know anything about it, no. But that's cool. I like that.
our viewers out there will correct me if I'm wrong about that. I trust there's somebody smarter about Empire lore than me somewhere. Okay, so I guess as far as battles go, this is another one of those battles that takes 4 or 5 pages to describe the ongoing grind of you know, one army versus the next, and there's ebbs and flows that come. Lots of things die. Exciting things happen. With Skaven, of course, there's many explosions, and there's some fleeing, and then there's some rallying, etc., etc.
One quick note: when we're looking at the as often, the forces arrayed are always interesting to look at, and there were two things I wanted to call out in the forces taking part in this battle that I found humorous. The first is that, as I said, like on the actual force chart for this, it actually lists the Rats of Nuln as one of the Skaven troops that are attacking. And when you go to the right and see what that is 50 rat swarms in game terms. 50. 50 rat swarms.
That doesn't seem like enough, honestly.
That's a lot of rat swarms. That's 250 wounds of rat swarms. That's a lot.
Let's do the math and understand how much volume of space that would hold up. So if you got 40 mil bases, or for those in imperial measure, almost 2 inches. So you got 2-inch squares.
Yep.
Times 50, right?
Yep.
You got 100 square inches.
Yeah, if they were ranked, right? If they were to actually form a rank, like 5 by 10, yeah, then they would be 10 inches across. Is that right? 2 inches. Yeah. 10 inches across.
Yeah.
And they would be 20 inches deep. So you couldn't even, they'd have to be sideways in a deployment area. They couldn't even fit in a Blood and Glory in that formation, I guess.
Yeah. So I guess 200 square inches. Hey. Oh, well.
Yeah.
That'll try to deploy that on your
table. That's a lot of rats. Yes. the other thing I like in this battle is just the actual steam tank, which you mentioned already, which is Deliverance. Although that might ring some bad bells, pun intended, for people with a movie. I think there's also something appropriate to what happens in that movie to what is about to happen to Nuln. There's parallels. So there you go.
Doesn't the steam tank kind of comes up from behind, doesn't it?
A little bit
of the Skaven,
mm-hmm.
You know, once they're into the square, and it comes in from behind them with the relief force, so to speak.
Yes.
Very nice. I want to mention, seeing as we just talked about it, I want to mention one of the coolest things in of the units, and that is this group of guys called the Electric Coven, not the Electric Coven. Let's be clear about that. Starting with an L. Electric Coven. Now these are a group of engineers that are just all armed with shock prods and warp generators. So they all hang together in advance. And I actually looked into this. There's a scenario in the other Thanquol book that lets you take the Electric Coven for free, and it is all Skaven engineers. There's 13 of them, oddly enough, and that's like a special unit that you can take in this scenario. That recreates this battle for no point cost.
Nice. I like that, because you look at those 15-point engineers and you're like, I should build a unit out of those sometime. You know, just have a unit of all characters. And they thought the same thing, and they pulled the trigger on that. I love it.
I did indeed. Okay. So in the battle itself here, he doesn't really play a big role, but Grand Marshal Erkstein is the guy that leads the Nuln army as a whole. And he brings in his knights at some point to trample some Skaven down, faces off against some Storm Fiends, because Storm Fiends are the new hotness in the Skaven world, starting to turn up at every corner. So that's where they run into their biggest trouble. But that's another one of the ebbs and flows of the battle. He doesn't really play a big part otherwise. And then one other character that pops up is our friend that we touched on a little bit earlier, Bernt Aberwald, who is an amber wizard. He jumps on his two-headed blue griffin to come and swoop down and cause some havoc amongst the Skaven and make them flee for a little bit as well. But in the end, inevitably, the force of numbers just prevail. But is there any key moments of that battle that tickled you or that you wanted to bring attention to?
Bone Ripper showed up to this fight armed with his crusher fists as opposed to his warp fire throwers. Mm. And he gets charged by like a whole block of blazing sun knights and just proceeds to smash them into smithereens, which I particularly like because that is certainly what those fists will do. In game terms, they ignore armor. And it even, you know, and so like he just punches cavalry into paste, which I particularly like. And I Thanquol is up on top of him, you know, like kicking him and telling him to go and move and stop that. But Thanquol won't, or Bone Ripper doesn't. He just gets down and starts eating them, like right there. He almost as though he's got the Minotaur penalty or whatever, where they've got to like feast on their enemies so they don't pursue as much. But yeah, I like watching him smash the people. I like the big warp fists are fun.
Yeah. And it shows you how much true control Thanquol has over his bodyguard mount.
Yeah, also true.
I.e. not much.
Yes.
Okay. So we should add here that the mighty bell has been ringing along at regular intervals here. And as we come to the close of the battle, it rings for its 12th time. And that's about the culmination where all of the forces of Skaven have just proven too much for the Empire, and they do their final retreat and break and run in the face of all that onslaught that's coming upon them. And then the doom bell rings one last time, the 13th time. So again, very symbolic of the Skaven, and that's really it. Buildings start and fall down. The Empire men are broken and there's nobody left to stand against the Skaven. So they all get to look around at each other and feel triumphant that the great horned rat has smiled upon them and they've achieved all of their goals right here. So it finishes up by telling about how Captain Drexler has managed to cobble together some survivors and escape out the south gates, while Emanuela von Liebowitz has also managed to escape out to the east, and a refugee column just kind of exits Nuln, and the city or any survivors are just abandoning that to the rats. So it's over for Nuln at that point.
Yep. The city has fallen. And we close out with a nice little scene with Thanquol and his Vermin Lord patron.
Yeah, before you do that, actually.
Oh, sure.
Before you do that, I wanted to ask one question because I was looking back upon this. And did our other little Skaven warlord survive this?
They don't tell you, I don't think. I'm pretty sure you never find out his fate. You just have the Vermin Lord warn him and say, like, hey, if he survives, you know, he's going to try to kill you. Just, you know, heads up on that.
Yeah, that happened a bit earlier in the chapter, so I was wondering if Trickstab actually made it through here. I think he fled at one point, but I can't recall if he came back into the fray or not.
And yeah, I think they leave kind of his ultimate fate open, which in the Warhammer world means, yeah, he survived.
Yeah, I guess so. Okay, wrap it up. Tell us what Thanquol and Vermin King are up to now.
So the Vermin Lord and Thanquol are sitting there, and you know, Thankwell's like, all right, what now? Do we go? Because he knows some people got away. You know, we're gonna go pursue them, just kind of kill everybody. And the Vermin Lord's like, no, you know, we got other things we got to do. And he sort of slams his staff on the ground, and he massive skitter leaps, as it were, all the way to Skaven Blight. And he says, all right. He goes off toward the great temple, the Horned Rat, and says, it's time we told the council of our plans. And that's where we leave off with them. Kind of a very foreboding thing, as we'll see later, of what that means.
Yeah, he does say in here that, first me was skitterly to Skaven Blight, little horned one. then to the lair of the lizard things. Perhaps not long. Perhaps not long near the lizard thing's lair is the words that he says to Thanquol. So
yes.
Think about that, peoples. Where could that mean, the lair of the lizard things? Well, maybe we'll have to pause to find out, because that actually brings us to the conclusion of chapter 4 of the End Times Thanquol. So poor old Empire takes it on the chin again. And the mighty Skaven are looking more powerful than ever. They strung a few successes in a row together. So I don't know if we get to call that a streak, but we shall see if that continues. So we're going to sign off for now. Clan leader Vince, thanks for the insights.
Absolutely. Good to see that vile city finally fall.
Yeah. Okay, and for the rest of you watching, this is the Far Squeaker turning off.
In their mind walking, the Slan hovered over Zakutek. The rift in reality in the City of Echoes was strangely becalmed. For the first time in years, no demons issued forth from that tear in the world's fabric. It was dangerous for the spirit consciousnesses of the Slan to contemplate that forsaken place too long. What lived on the other side of the veil could discern them. The cold logic of the Slan's presence shone like a beacon to those in a realm of insatiable desires and swirling emotion. In the past, the dark powers had sought to entangle the Slan, to lock their agile minds into labyrinthine traps that befuddled their thoughts. Now, however, there was no sign of this old threat, but a niggling echo troubled the Slan still. From the limit of perception, came a far-off rumbling, like thunder over the horizon. It was an unnatural sound, like the mocking laughter of the gods.
Welcome, sitting down again in the den with my fellow philosophers, Keith and Vince. Give everybody a nice wave. They can't see you right now, because waves are silent.
Hi, everybody. But
anyway, I am coming to you from the shadows, much like the Vermin Lords that every Skaven possesses across the old world lately. And we are moving on from where we left it in Nome, and the great successes of Thanquol. And now here we are returning to an old spot where we started this tome about Thanquol. And here we are back in Lustria. So this is a great moment for you two fellas, Keith, who has always loved the Lizard Man, and Vince, who is leading the Shadow Council tonight to represent his Skaven. And this will be a good opportunity for you guys to have a go at one another, I think, as there's a lot at stake here this time. So let's maybe begin by putting it to you two guys to tell us each of your respective bodies' stances at the opening of this. I'll let you fight over who goes first.
Oh, I will. Skaven always let the other guy go first.
Well, that's fine. I will take first turn. Well, I would stands. I mean, Clan Pestilions, they had what the Skaven call an absolutely major assault on Lustria way back in the first few chapters, where they had a three-pronged attack on some of the major cities belonging to the Lizardmen. And to be quite frank, they failed miserably in their attempts. Their main objective was to incapacitate the Slan. And so there was a battle of wills for a little while between the Slan and the Grey Seers to pull the moon closer to the old world. And admittedly, the Grey Seers were able to do that a little bit, but they were ultimately thwarted by the Slan. But in their efforts, the Slan were rendered unconscious for a little bit, and that's when the Skaven began their assault. For their efforts, they managed to overrun the City of the Moon, Vlaxlan. But in their attempts, they became a little overzealous, and the majority of the Slan were evacuated thanks to the foresight of Keto Echo, who then dropped the biggest comet ever seen in the old world, wiping out the city and destroying one of the Skaven armies totally. Then the Skaven launched an assault on the first city of the Lizardmen, Itza, where they laid siege to the city and basically bombarded it with several plagues, but that was rescued by the forces of the Prophet of Sotek. And so Itza still stands, albeit it's a little bit uninhabitable because of the dirty gases which were dispersed at Skaven. And then finally, two separate assaults were set upon the City of the Mists by two different plague lords. And they made it past the mists themselves, and they made it to the city where they were able to kill maybe one or two of the lower slans, so we're not too worried about that, before Krokgar turns up himself and repels the Skaven. So I would count that as a resounding victory for the Lizardmen throughout, where the great invasion of Lustria was almost brushed off without a second thought. We lost a couple of times, maybe one of the cities were destroyed, but ultimately the hordes and multitudes of the rats were completely repelled.
Well, so what's your rebuttal to that, Vince?
Well, I wasn't aware that the Lizardmen hired William Randolph Hearst. There was such a spin job on that it's hard to believe that could ever be taken seriously. I would like to start by addressing the nature of somewhat uninhabitable. That's like being somewhat pregnant or somewhat dead. It either is or isn't. Itza is an empty city, bereft of foul Lizardmen life, because the toxins on it are so thick. And even all of the little sunshine and rain and happy unicorns and flowers that, as we open this chapter, Mazdamundi and the other fat frogs have called down, haven't wiped that city clean because it's so thick with toxic waste that no one can get in there. And, yes, although I will gladly admit that the initial incursions of the Skaven were perhaps not as successful as one might want them to be, that is to say, there are still Lizardmen alive, the geomantic grid was completely depleted, broken all over the place, in many places. Tons of Lizardmen are dead, and most importantly, spawning pools by the hundreds are befouled. And the one problem with this is short-term victories don't work. And when you're fighting the Skaven, this is a war of attrition, and without their ability to pump out new lizard people, that is a war that the Lizardmen are just not going to win. So that is what I would say. The setup at the start of the chapter for us is very, very succinctly gets wrapped up actually on like sort of page 2 of the chapter, when Thanquol comes in to meet with Lord Skrulk, who is, of course, the sort of reports only to Nurglitch, the head of Clan Pestilence. And Skrulk has his own Vermin Lord backing him, of course, Vermilinx. And Thanquol basically says, you know, all right, we got a plan. And Thanquol sort of like kind of taking control there. And Skrulk says, well, we have the backing of Nurglitch. And then at that, the Vermin King, so Screech, this is Thankful's Vermin Lord, puffs up with sort of dark energy and says, we have the backing of the Shadow Council. And that's where you get the realization that just as the Skaven themselves have a Council of 13, above that sits a mirror Council of 13 of the sort of upper Vermin Lords themselves. And they have a big plan that they are trying to enact.
So had we heard of this before? Was there ever any lore in the Skaven about a higher-level council of perhaps Vermin Lords that ever alluded to that?
Not that I know of. I mean, I certainly haven't read, like, the novels and such, you know, so I don't know if it ever got maybe dropped or made reference to in a novel, but not in any of the sort of printed army books or anything like that have they ever made reference to that sort of a thing.
Yeah, I didn't think so either, but I thought I'd just run it by and see if I'd missed something. Something grand there.
Yeah, as far as I know, this is a totally new idea that this has been revealed. But, you know, that's the great part about Skaven. They're so mysterious and weird and everything's cloaked in shadow. It's like you can just make up whole things out of whole cloth and it'll just be like, yeah, that sure, that works. Why not?
Well, and who knows? This could be just a big lie by a Vermin King to frighten Skrulk into obedience as well.
Could be. Why not?
But maybe having said that, now I realize that probably Skrulk's little tag along, who is called Vermilinx, he would probably be aware of that at the very least.
Yes. He seems definitely cowed by Screech Vermin King. And Thanquol himself sort of, you know, knows that his guy is the more powerful than the other guy. He kind of had a sense of the power of the thing.
Yeah, good. Okay. Well, so this is so as you say, this is what launches the next assault of this Skaven on Lustria. So let's get into it, Keith. What are the lizards doing to prepare themselves?
Well, to bring something that Vince mentioned earlier about the geomantic web, it's a little bit damaged, I'll give you that, but it's around this time where we get one of those nice little timestamps again, where the great vortex is unraveling, and so the winds of magic are running rampant across the old world, and so the geomantic web is actually just overflowing with power. So it's at this point where the Slan are kind of deliberating amongst themselves, what are they going to do with this surgence of magical ability that they now have at their fingertips. And some of the younger Slan are advocating, let's just go straight to war, let's unleash our magics on the Skaven, and just totally banish them. But Mazdamundi, who is the greatest mage, the greatest living mage in the world today, has decided, no, let me sleep on it. I'll get back to you guys tomorrow when the stars are in a bit more favorable alignment, and I'll tell you what we're going to do with all this power. Now, while he's contemplating on this, Ortskralk has rallied his plague lords and has sent four of them off to Hoatl, which is where the city where Mazdamundi is in residence, and basically has told them to destroy as many of the Slan as they can, particularly Mazdamundi. And we'll get to that, why he's important, in a little bit. So essentially, they pack up their giant plague cauldrons and everything like that, and they start marching towards Hoatl.
Gotcha.
You want to take it there?
Yeah, so the Skaven rally up, and they're heading north, and basically what happens is the Lizardmen, they engage in the sort of shady behavior you would expect out of Lizardmen. They,
that's
really
coming from the Skaven.
Hey, no reason why the Skaven can't call the kettle black. So, the Skaven are basically marching straight north, and what they're getting, like, harried the whole time by these little cheater chameleon skinks and things that are sort of ambushing and picking off, small numbers here and there. This is where we learned that the Skaven are sort of now more in touch with the Vermin Lords than ever, as basically all of the warlords have been given the ability or the call to summon a Vermin Lord. And so the Vermin Lords kind of really turn the tide in a lot of these little ambushes. And, though the Skaven suffer some minor losses, in the end it doesn't do much to actually hurt their army. And it's probably about even as we finally come to the Obsidian Column or whatever, to Pahulax. That's where it is. I'm sorry. Is that how you say that? Pahax? Pahooks? Whatever.
I don't know.
Lizardmen names.
My thought is Pahwax, but,
I'll buy that.
Say what you will.
So
let's just make up the nickname of P-Town.
There you go. Yeah. So we come to we come to P-Town, and that's where we get a nice showdown. where basically we get a nice array, a nice battle array between sort of the two forces there. This is sort of the first Lizardmen Skaven battle. As this one's led by Teeny Weeny, who basically, he's going to make his stand here in these ruins. He's by nature sort of an ambusher. And, so his whole army is just kind of stretched out and ready to go. And, as dawn breaks, the Skaven and them, they get into a nice dust up. I think that's pretty much what's going on there.
There's one really cool description in this battle. So we talked a couple times about how the story reflects game mechanics every now and again. And there's this just one massively missed opportunity by Games Workshop and the Game Mechanics, where there's like a couple of Bastillodon, and two Bastillodon shoot their lasers into the third Bastillodon, and he shoots a super laser which destroys the plague furnace. And I wish they could do that. That would be amazing.
That is, yeah, they all just use them as like focusing beams.
Yeah, and then two lasers shoots up. That would be amazing if we did a Bastillodon to just destroy a plague furnace in one shot, but that is not.
That sounds too much. Sounds a little too much like Power Rangers joining their forces together to make some super Power Ranger.
Does it almost sound a little bit 40K like spaceships and lasers ish?
There's the laser beams everywhere on those lizards. Yeah, no.
Almost. Because that would be weird, Lizardmen, right?
Right, exactly. I mean, what would the Lizardmen have to do with space technology? It makes no sense. Why, there would be no connection. So these two armies fight, and the problem with Teeny-Weeny's force is that it's mostly, he has the big dinos, but his stuff is mainly made up of skinks. He doesn't have a lot of Saurus blocks like Krokgar does, and so he doesn't have the... He doesn't have sort of the ability to really get in there and stick and grind it out. And whereas the Skaven and their massive bodies, that just sort of endless sway, they do. So even though Teeny-Weeny has some good success early in the day, as the day wears on and battle continues, and more importantly, as, you know, this is a big pestilence army, and they are just carrying plague and sickness and disease with them. And, like, literally as the day goes on, the Lizardmen forces are just being overcome by not only the constant press of battle, but also just by the ever presence of these, by these diseases just wearing down their big monsters, and so it comes to the fact that Teeny-Weeny sort of knows he's going to lose, and he calls upon Sotek, and he sends out some snakes. Man, he calls down the snakes, and out comes a snake horde to fight the rat horde. And he buys himself some time to get away as he flees back to the north towards another Lizardman city. I won't pronounce where Mazdamundi is.
Hexwaddle.
There you go. That one.
I like that. Mm-hmm. Hexwaddle. So, yeah, after this battle, I guess, we kind of switch gears a little bit, and we go to Hexwaddle, which is where Mazdamundi is sitting in his throne and doing all of his massive contemplatings. But there's a couple page spread here of a cutscene that I thought was really cool.
Can I just make one final point about Tang Wan's last ditch effort? Did either of you guys get the kind of parallel between him sending forth a horde of snakes to delay the Skaven army, and then Thanquol sent forth a horde of rats and vermin to in his last assault on Null?
I kind of felt that was a bit of a different thing. Like in Nuln, Thanquol put forward those rats as his vanguard, whereas the snakes of Sotek are just coming out as a delaying action when they decided they've already lost. That's a bit of a different thing.
All right, I kind of got it as like the I guess maybe the avatars of their race sending forth the base denizens of what their race represents in order to either defend yourself or basically accomplish their goals. Thought that was kind of interesting.
Yeah, sure.
Sorry, go on, here.
No, I was still gonna leave it to you guys if you wanted to have a little bit of a Vince, if you wanna tell us about this little assassin who is.
There was no way we were skipping this. Absolutely. Yeah, this bit of cheating from this ridiculous guy here. Yes, so the Black 13, which are like a super, the super assassins of Clan Eshin. There are only two assassins in the world who are better than the Black 13. And I'm counting all those cheater Dark Elves, because those guys are nothing. Even what's his name, Shadowblade, he's a joke. There's only two Skaven assassins better than the Black 13. And we focus in on this one particular assassin who is climbing his way up the pyramid, and these guys, the Black 13, is on a very special mission. They're here to assassinate Mazdamundi. And he's making his way up the big pyramid where Mazdamundi lives. And he is, like, being very careful and slow and climbing. And he sneaks his way into a crack, and he's way down in a shadow, all huddled in blackness, when his whiskers start twitching, which he takes as a sign of danger. He like, his whiskers twitch whenever there's danger around. And so he sort of draws his weapon and gets ready. And that's when we meet one of the characters of the Lizardmen army who is charged with defending Mazdamundi in this little pyramid. I'll let you take this part, Keith, since it's this one's a win for the Lizardmen.
I think yeah. It's probably... Is it just that you don't want to try to pronounce his name?
I definitely don't want to pronounce this guy's name.
All right, Keith, go to it.
So this guy is the chameleon skink Oxyotl. And his kind of claim to fame is that when one of the Lizardmen cities was basically sucked into the warp at one point, or all the denizens of the city, he was sucked in along with them, and he was the only guy to get out alive, but it took him 6,000 years, so he's seen things. He's a chameleon skink of great renown. He's hanging out on the side of the pyramid, and the Skaven assassin is basically freaking out. His little whiskers are twitching all over the place. His tail is moving involuntarily. He's basically terrified because he knows he's being stalked, and he can't see what's stalking him. So he huddles up like a coward he is in his little nook in the pyramid, and he puts his cloak over him, and he draws his weapons. His senses are going mad. And then he thinks that he sees maybe a little bit of rock or something that looks like rock just twitch a little bit, and then he just feels an icy sharp pain in his neck. And at that point, it's too late. The poison has already gotten him. And he dies. And Oxyotl just wanders off into the night because his mission's not done. He's still got some Skaven to hunt.
Yeah, I would just like to point out that this guy is like Predator. Like, they even talk about him adjusting his eyes to see into the infrared spectrum. Take it down a notch there, Predator. Jeez, like, I'd expected, like, claws to pop out of his hand, a little machine. I'm sure that blowpipe was probably shoulder-mounted.
That little targeting array, a little triangle.
The three red dots were on the Skaven, yeah.
I also think one kind of amazing thing how they describe Oxyotl is that they say that not only does he take on the color of the stone that he's up against, but he takes on the texture as well in his skin tone as it shifts in chameleons.
Yeah.
So how do you guard against that? Be impressive.
Well, best assassins are off doing other things. You know, I mean, we've got we'll come to the rest of them later.
As you said, Vince, there are only two Skaven assassins that are better than the Black 13, but clearly the Lizardmen can put up a much higher caliber kind of hit-and-run stealth specialist than these Skaven can, so we'll take that one.
Yes, your top-tier guy did defeat our B-list guy. I will admit that. That's fine.
Okay. Well, let's separate you guys before the fisticuff starts. And we should move on to, I guess what's really happening here is that Skaven army is marching north still, closing in on Hexwaddle, and it's up to Mazdamundi again to make a big decision. Keith, what's his decision?
So Mazdamundi wakes up, and he receives the message that the Skaven are approaching, and he says, get my Stegadon ready, we're going to war. So his giant palanquin gets on top of his Stegadon Black, who is clearly not a copyright infringement of any kind of transformer, and they assemble the army out in front of the approaching Skaven. And as he wakes up, he was in this deep trance about what he was going to do with his geomantic power, and he feels that he's just on this cusp of understanding something, that something has been obscuring his vision, and there's a big revelation just there for the reaching, but he just can't quite get it. So the Lizardmen army, they start marching south, and the Skaven are marching north, and they come together, and Mazdamundi kind of decides, well, you know what? I might not be the best guy to lead this army. So he opens up a portal and summons in the legendary Krokgar, who is this ancient, old blood general warrior who just is mounted on his massive Carnosaur. And the Carnosaur recognizes Mazdamundi's power and stifles the roar of challenge that he's about to issue and instead bows his head. So that's the kind of power that the Lizardmen are bringing to the table here.
Yeah.
So they...
If I can just slip in here, the last time that we saw Krokgar was in the City of Mists, wasn't it? He came to the rescue of the city in the 11th hour?
That's right. Yeah, so he... he charged in there, started to escape.
Carry on, Keith.
Oh, sorry. So he charged in there, he scattered the Skaven, and then he returned back to his original city, whose name I actually can't remember right now. But he's constantly guarding from the demon incursion. But Mazdamundi summons him because he figures this is a lot more important right now. So the two armies kind of meet, and there are three plague lords who really can't decide who gets to assault the Lizardmen first. So they all just decide to charge at the same time. And the fourth guy is kind of hanging back. He's the Pontificus of Plagues. He's the guy in charge of cooking up all the Pestilion's diseases. So Mazdamundi sees this, and then with a very leisurely flick of his wrist, he sends forth a massive shockwave through the earth and just kills thousands of Skaven and buries all of their plague cauldrons. So with the plague cauldrons buried, and the haze of distraction and that miasma gone, Mazdamundi's foresight is revealed. And we kind of get this revelation now that the Skaven are just puppets to the Vermin Lord, and the Vermin Lords themselves are just puppets to the Horned Rat, which is the Skaven god. But then he figures out that it goes deeper, and that the Horned Rat itself is actually a slave or a puppet to the Chaos gods. And that the rats are just a tool, essentially, of the big four. But he also sees a little bit further than that. He sees that the rats are going beyond their brief that the Chaos Gods have set them. And that what they're planning right now, the schemes that they're concocting with the moon and everything like that, and their invasion of the whole world, that will destroy everything. Like, just leave the world a husk. Which is not really in Chaos's best interest, because, you know, the Chaos Gods like their little games with mortals, and they have their followers all over the world. And what he figures out is that he needs more power to stop what they're doing, and to do that he needs to go to the first city, Itza, because Itza is the central point of that geomantic web. So all that overflowing power that's coming from the Great Vortex right now, that's all centered in Itza. And that this entire army, these four plague lords sent to Hexawattle to try and kill him, that's all just a distraction. So what he does is he waves his hand again, he opens up a portal to Itza, and takes his entire army there in the blink of an eye. But who's there in that inhospitable city but Skrulk? And he's deeply, deeply entrenched there already.
Yep.
Yeah.
And so, we get a nice cutaway, if I might there. Kieran, just to handle this nice cutaway with Thanquol and Screech real quick.
Go.
Before we get to that battle. So we pick up with Thanquol and Screech Vermin King, and they're sort of off alone, you know, as the two of them, the two of them are really kind of, they're broing out throughout a lot of this. They roll around the world together and have adventures. And they find themselves in a wrecked, just awful, gray city. And Thanquol says, you know, where are we? And the Vermin King says, they call it Zahutek or something, whatever. This is the Chaos City that Krokgar was guarding, where this demon incursions were. And they see all these old twisted runes around, and Thanquol recognizes them. And they see sort of movement within an archway not too far away. And what's really interesting here is the Vermin King sort of can naturally see magic. He has this very, like, as he says, warp-attuned eye. And he looks into the arch and actually, like, steps backward in fear and has the sort of same fear reaction that the Lesser Skaven have so easily. And this unnerves Thanquol, as you know, anything that would frighten the vermin lord is incredibly disturbing to him. As if still in a trance, Vermin King wavered, his voice a whisper. The vermin lord recounted, "Armies beyond count, rage beyond understanding. They wait for us, watching us." And I think that's a, like, that statement right there, it's sort of the first time you realize, throughout all of this, I think, just what is sitting on the other side of this. This thing that is talking is, you know, one of the more powerful beings in the Warhammer world, this massive vermin lord. He is the head of the vermin lords, you know, or what, as it were. He's an incredibly potent being, and he just glances into this portal, and the vastness of what it is wasn't even sort of aware. Even he couldn't picture before this moment how massive chaos is, the vastness and unending nature of it, right? And it disturbs him to his sort of to his core. And he says to Thanquol, he says, you know, what are we going to do? What can we do? And Vermin King says, nothing, you know, not yet. But it is what he says. Like, he seems to imply he's got a plan, but even he admits it's hopeless at this point.
Yeah. So this kind of lends to what Keith was saying earlier about Mazdamundi's realizations. So what do you think to that, the theory that there's all these layers to the Skaven, but yet they are subservient to the gods of chaos?
Yeah, I think that there'll be a moment kind of we come to later where the vermin lords kind of talk about what their actual plan was and sort of what they, how things work out. But I think they're dimly aware of this idea that, you know, chaos is sort of the power behind them, but at the same time, I think that, like all good Skaven, they believe that they can fight their way up the ranks, right? I think they, I don't think they see themselves as much of pawns as they probably are. Does that make sense? They see themselves as like knights or bishop on the chessboards. They don't see themselves as pawns.
Yeah, they see certainly other races as lesser than them, even at the very least, even if they can't call themselves the king.
Right.
I agree with that analogy. Sounds right.
I don't even think that you could call them subservient, because that implies a level of obedience. Whereas I think, you know, the chaos powers are just kind of saying, hey, you need to get this done, and then the Skaven just start doing wacky crap, and if it gets that stuff done, then that's okay, but they're going to do it their own way. And a lot of random stuff is going to happen in between. And that's kind of what you got to love about Skaven, right?
Absolutely. I mean, I think there's also probably a lot of telephone going on, right? Between, like, the Chaos Gods talking to the Horned Rat, talking to the Vermin Lords, talking to the Council, talking to their warlords, and then finally commanding Skaven. It started out as, like, destroy the Empire, but then it ended up build a giant rocket to blow up the moon. I mean, you know, when you play telephone, it's just crazy what comes out the other side.
Yeah, indeed. Well, that's probably as good a segue as any to I guess now that we know that Mazdamundi has teleported his force away from Huaxuato to go to Itza, and he's going to have a showdown with Skrulk, there's something going on the other side of the world that we need to visit here a little bit. Back in Skavenblight, the things that we opened up the story with, if I can recall our viewers back to what we first introduced, is that after the Grey Seers were kicked off the council and things got realigned, et cetera, then this grand plan came up to, well, the Grey Seers were pulling the moon closer, but the Clan Scryer folks were trying to build a rocket to blow up the moon. They got the things that they needed out of Nome to do this, so now we got to switch our attention back to Skavenblight, and let's get an update. How are we doing in Skavenblight, Vince?
Yeah, so obviously Ikenclaw had the idea. He had made the Doom Rocket, and so he thought, well, I'll just make a bigger Doom Rocket and blow up the moon. There we go. And then we'll have all the warp stone we need, and everything will be great. But he had sort of fallen out of favor and gotten sent up north. We remember him sort of in one of the previous chapters where we dealt with his machinations up in the north. And instead, he was supplanted by a guy named Zingtail. Zingtail thought to, you know, like, I'm going to show everybody, I'll be much better than Ikenclaw ever was. And he's building something that he only calls the device. He refuses to sort of give it a name, a goofy name, like, or to name it after himself. They propose calling it the Zinj Cannon, but instead it just ends up being sort of colloquially called the Morskitter Engine. And all around Skaven Blight, it is this massive sort of thing of warp stone and focusing crystals and you know, all this stuff. And it's just a giant steam engines and everything. And it's all just powering and cogs and wheels turning. And this giant machine is basically, it's building up power. Like, as we meet him, he's sort of flipping the switch to get it on and start to collect power. But he has to get it to just the right point. One can almost imagine him, like, watching the little pressure gauge, and he's just watching the needle, like, slowly climb. And it has to get to just the right point. If it goes too far, boom. If it doesn't go far enough, not enough, boom. He needs exactly the right boom. And that's where, and this is all about to happen.
Yeah, so he's all firing it up, and Mazdamundi senses that great power growing shortly after he gets to Itza. But he's not entirely sure, I don't think at this point, what it's all about. But he just senses that bad things are about to happen. Okay, well, so let's bring it back to Itza after that little interlude, because there is a big battle about to happen. Keith, you want to take us through the... Any particular details of the opening part of this that caught your eye?
Well, I guess it's not so much as a battle as a race, where Mazdamundi kind of, he feels his disturbance in the Force, which is the Morskitter engine going off, and he realizes, I gotta get to the central pyramid of Itza, and I gotta get there fast. So it's really just the Lizardmen trying to punch a wedge through just the sea of Skaven and get him to that central pyramid before the Lizardmen get totally overwhelmed. Krakar, he leads the assault. Him and Grimlock, they start charging head-on into it, and they're backed up by Mazdamundi, who's on a Stegon, who's just stamping Skaven into paste. And he's in the center, surrounded by his Temple Guard, and they're going to work. In the meantime, we find Tic-Tac-Toe, who is a Skaven or a Skink Pterodon rider. Those guys are swooping in. They're dropping their rocks on top of the Skaven, and Ripidactyls are coming around. So essentially, everything's just trying to clear a path to the central pyramid. And it's about the time that the giant warp lightning cannon goes off, the Mazdamundi is putting himself in a trance, and he's able to have this like out-of-body experience where he floats up into the heavens and sees the giant warp lightning cannon punch into the surface of the moon, start boiling the core of the moon, and then all these massive fragments start splintering off and start crashing down towards the Earth. So Zinjtail's plan works, his Morskitter engine goes off, and they've essentially blown up the moon.
Yeah.
What's happening? Yeah. Go on.
No, I was going to say that there's also a little bit of a interaction here going on between Krokgar as he's kind of leading the Juggernaut to knife through the Skaven forces. But, of course, our Skaven hero, leader of the assault on Lustria, the Grand Poobah of all Skavendom in the jungles, Lord Skrulk, is there standing in his way. And we have a little bit of a challenge, an epic challenge between these two. Vince, you want to tell us about this one?
Yes, sadly. So.
You've already given it away.
I have no poker face when it comes to this. So Lord Skrulk, who did admittedly start out by murdering Krokgar's Carnosaur, which I appreciate that at least. Thank you. Like, he kills his dumb dinosaur, so that's a nice thing. What's that?
I said it was in one single whack with his little staff, wasn't it?
Yes, it was. Yeah, he just... And then down the big thing goes. But Krokgar is not so easily felled, and he gets down. And, you know, like, Lord Skrulk is really fast because he's a Skaven and a very powerful one, and he sort of evades his blows and kind of whacks Krokgar with his big poison flail. And, you know, most creatures, if they're even touched by that thing, just are immediately overcome by diseases and drop dead. But of course, Krokgar is just the oldest of oldest old blood, Peter old bloods, and he shakes it off like he's in a Taylor Swift video, and proceeds to ram his heavenly light-blessed spear right through Lord Skrulk's gut and pretty much kills him outright, just like whammo-blammo. Skrulk is like sitting there teetering on the edge of life, pretty much dead. And that's when Vermilanx shows up. So Vermilanx is Lord Skrulk's sort of personal vermin lord. And, you know, in one of the previous videos, I mentioned how these vermin lords almost treat the Skaven that summon them as their pets. And I think this is, or like children, you know, that kind of thing. And you see that again here. Vermilanx is this mighty, powerful vermin lord who, you know, probably if anything stood a chance in a direct fight with Krokgar, it would have been this thing. But instead of fighting him, he runs over and pulls Skrulk off of the spear and, like, uses magic to, like, plague magic to heal Lord Skrulk by growing new tumors and things in the hole, and then just skitter leaps away with him very quickly, taking Lord Skrulk to safety so he can, I guess, he can protect his little doggy who had been very badly injured. It's a strange fight, honestly, because Krokgar wins it without, honestly, much of a fight. And to have the Vermin Lord then show up and just take Skrulk, fix him, and leave as opposed to fighting, it's a weird scene.
Well, what saves Krokgar is he's got this blessed hand of the gods. He has this big claw hand that's made of some otherworldly metal, and that's what he uses to grasp a hold of Skrulk's plague staff that he's trying to whack down on him. And he essentially uses that, and it's, you know, got, it's effectively with Carnosaur couldn't the power of light magic, so that's what Satan does. The key thing for Krokgar to pull that out.
Yes.
Doesn't before, and one other thing I thought about here, doesn't Vermilanx give a little bit of a vomit trail before he takes off?
He does, yeah. He spews out this big, wide, vomitous stream. And, like, I think some of the other errant things in the area die. And then he just, like, bah, he vomits everywhere and leaves a bunch of plague around. And then he bounces.
Yeah. But, again, it says the Krokgar is protected somewhat from that by his hand of the gods and the light magic being viewed within. So he's got, like, the lucky talisman there that protects him from all that putridness.
Yes. Yes, indeed. Yeah.
So at least we know that Skrulk is not dead, though. That's the one silver lining there for the Skaven peoples.
Yeah, absolutely. They both, effectively, at the end of the fight, nothing is decided, right? The Krokgar lost a dinosaur, but other than that, no. Assumingly, both parties do live in some way, although clearly the Skaven came out the worst in that particular engagement.
Yeah.
Well, I wouldn't say nothing was decided. I'd say it was decided that Skrulk sucks in a fight and that Vermilanx is an absolute dirty coward and Krokgar is awesome. So I'd say that was pretty well decided.
All right. Well, then, maybe we should let you take it from there and tell us what Mazdamundi is up to amongst all this mess, all that distraction's happening.
Before that, I would, just as a little aside, so bearing in mind that the unbinding of the Great Vortex has already happened at this point, and we have a few winds of magic that, like, ran astray. So we had fire, metal, and beasts. And when Krokgar was surrounded in his nimbus of light, and he survived the encounter with Skrulk, he crushed his plague flail, and he survived the vomiting of Vermilanx, I honestly thought that at this point, he would be revealed to be the incarnate of beasts. I thought that would be a really great fit for him. But that doesn't go on there. I was wondering, do you have that kind of thought or anything similar to that, or thinking about those errant winds of magic at this point?
Well, I guess I did think briefly about one parallel there, if maybe he was the incarnate of light, perhaps, is what I more thought of. That would have been more likely. Because although it says that at the end of Cain that Teclis binds it to his staff, he doesn't imbue it on an incarnate like the other ones were. So I thought that maybe there was some unwritten thing that happened here where Teclis released it from his staff and it could have come to be imbued into Krokgar. So yes, I did have that sort of thought on some parallel.
Yeah.
I just viewed it as super old bloods are already impossible to kill. Special character oldest of the old bloods is like toughness a million. That guy's impossible to wound ever. Like, I just take it as they are really some of just as straight warriors, you know. These old bloods are not to be underestimated. Like, not to speak just in game terms, but in the sort of verisimilitude of the world, the most potent of Soros old bloods are the match for, you know, even Chaos exalted heroes and stuff like that. These are some of them. They have been genetically bred for thousands of years to be perfected warriors, right?
Mm-hmm. All right, sure.
So you're willing to chalk it up to Lizardmen goodness, not to any dirty tricks? Surprises me, Vince.
Well, also, he had dirty tricks of, like, basically 40K technology in that item, because I'm not buying it. That mysterious metal of the Lizardmen, yeah, I think we all know where that came from.
Yeah. Impact.
Yes.
Okay. So again, while this is all going on, Mazdamundi is in his little trance, and he's making calculations. He's adding up all the sums and doing physics. Because the moon has been shattered and everything's plummeting towards the Earth, so he's getting his Sheldon Cooper hat on to try to determine how much time he's got, etc., etc. In the meantime, his poor old Stegodon is having to stomp away at Skaven that are trying to climb up his backside to get at Mazdamundi, and he's pretty hard pressed. But Mazdamundi does come back to consciousness, and this is where I'll pass it to you, Keith, and you can tell us what he does from there.
Mm-hmm. So, Mazdamundi figures he's got about 2 hours before these giant meteors impact the Earth and it's totally destroyed. So he opens up a portal, which will lead him straight to the entrance to the Great Pyramid. And he's been reluctant to do this thus far because he's kind of afraid that he knows something is stalking him. Like, he can feel, you know, a presence in the warp, if you like. But, you know, desperate times, desperate measures. So he teleports himself to the entrance of the pyramid. And behind him, though, when he's in what they call, like, the shadow space, he hears this laughter. And, you know, you assume it's a vermin lord, or maybe it's the horned rat himself. But he makes it through unscathed. He makes it into the pyramid. And he starts shooting off these telepathic messages. So he tells Krokgar, you need to get to the obelisk of the silver stars, I think it's called. And he tells all of the other Slan, look, the exodus has begun. Start getting your stuff together. So Krokgar, after just having beaten Skrull, he summons this mighty roar, and out of the jungle, another Carnosaur appears, which is really convenient. So he hops on his back and he runs to the obelisk of the Silver Stars. All of the other Slan start assembling their skink attendants, and all of these chambers, which have been sealed for millennia, begin to open. Stairs, which nobody knew were stairs, began to appear. All of this starts happening. The Slan and their attendants, they enter these chambers, and this exodus begins. And so this is what we've been alluding to before, where essentially these massive temples and chambers and pyramids, they lift off from the ground, and they essentially head off into space.
If I can say one thing there real quick, Keith.
Oh, yeah, please.
What I love about this is that they mention that the pyramids themselves, which everybody thought were just pyramids, are like icebergs, right? That's that tip you see, which these pyramids are huge, right? These are like our world's version of pyramids. They're these big, giant stone things. We think of the pyramids quite big. They're, in fact, only like 10, 20% of the total thing, which just rends itself up from the Earth, these massive, massive ships as they take off. I thought that's a really cool visual.
That's right, and that's actually, whatever page that's on has the best piece of artwork, in my opinion, in all of the End Times books. I haven't got it on here, so I can't show people, but they're just fantastic bit where you see these massive pyramids. There it is, yeah, and the lightning coming out of it, and you see the Stegodons.
Yeah, there you go. I'll talk real quick so that my screen goes center for a second.
Yes. Keep it up there, Vince. I'm going to lock on you while Keith carries on with his talk, so it's locked on you.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, there it is. So yeah, so the Slan and there's...
There you go. Okay, carry on, Keith.
The Slan and their skink attendants, they're leaving the world, but it makes a very important point that the majority of the Lizardmen stay behind. So the Saurus and those kind of guys, they're sticking around. But some of the Slan stay too, because Mazdamundi needs help in gathering the geomantic web, and he's going to go for one last-ditch effort to save the world from these giant continent-sized meteors which are about to hit the planet. Now there's a couple of a little asides here as well where it mentions the rest of the battle that's going on at Itza. And one of the things that I thought was kind of interesting was they mentioned a battle over the spawning pool. And how the spawning pools have basically a magical shield over the top, which is protecting them from the corruption that the Skaven are laying about the place, and that no side is gaining an advantage. And to kind of cut to the chase, by the end of the chapter, we don't know what happens to these spawning pools. So we don't know whether or not the Skaven get to them and are managed to poison them. We don't know if they're part of these pyramids that go off into space. We don't know if the Lizardmen are able to save them in the end. So anyway, Mazdamundi, he gets to the top of the tower, and he's basically mind-punching meteors using the power of the geomantic web and the aid of the other Slan to punch these meteors into the sides of the mountains and then slap them down into even smaller sizes. And it goes on to give this great visual that if any of these things had hit the Earth, it would have set the atmosphere on fire, and the tsunamis that it would have created would have just coated, it would have just sunk the entire old world. Like, it would have just been underwater, like Atlantis style. But Mazdamundi is able to deflect or batter away the majority of these things before he eventually is rendered unconscious. So time passes, and we don't really know how much, but he wakes up, and he can still sense that there's enough meteors coming that will destroy the world several times over. And at this point, we cut away to the very top of the pyramid, and there is Lord Croak, who is the very first Slan ever created, who is the only Slan that is alive, because he's a relic priest, which has ever actually gazed upon the Old Ones. And he was there when the Old Ones created the races of the world, and now he's present to see their death. And the meteors would have completely destroyed the world if it wasn't for Croak. So he quelled the tidal waves and he stopped the giant fires. And what he did was he channeled that energy into creating bubbles of arcane energy around key points in Lustria and lifted them up and sent them beyond the horizon before he himself was consumed in fire. And so there we have the exodus of the Lizardmen, if you like. So they get away in space, in their spaceships, and they get away in their bubbles of arcane protection as created by Lord Croak.
So here was my take on that final stage of it, is after all the mind bullets were shooting up into the sky from the Slan to try to knock these meteorites down, or at least dissipate them, and then they have that realization that, well, that's just not going to be enough. I got the impression that the last-ditch maneuver by all the Slan collectively that Mazdamundi had been telepathically in concert with here, just decided to sacrifice Lustria, and they funneled all that stuff to bash down on Lustria itself. Because that's kind of how it worked, wasn't it? Like, it didn't slam down in other parts of the old world. And then Croak's effort was to protect little bubble areas of Lustria from the eventual devastation of the entire continent. That sound right?
Yeah, you're right. It specifically says in the text that Lustria and the Southlands, which are the domains of the Lizardmen, were completely destroyed, aside from what Lord Croak himself was able to protect. But what I found interesting was that it never specifically says what Lord Croak saves, and as we pointed out in past reviews, specifically in Kane, is you never count a special character dead until someone has taken off their head. And we know Krakdar was racing towards this obelisk, which I'm choosing to interpret as a spaceship. We've had mention of Tic-Tac-Toe and Chakax and Tehenwan, and the only Slytherin special character that they've specifically said has died is Lord Croak himself, who goes off in a blaze of glory, quite literally. So I'm quite confident the Lizardmen are still there in some capacity.
Mazdamundi dies as well. You do get an explicit death of him.
Does it? I thought it just said he was rendered unconscious and he could still sense the meteors, and then we go to Lord Croak.
No, they do actually say, like you're right, he does go unconscious at one time, and then he revives himself to find himself on the cold floor with you know, bleeding out of his ear holes and his nostrils. And he tries to climb his way back onto his palanquin, and he doesn't make it. Yeah. So, sorry, Keith. Well, I mean, his head didn't get lopped off, so you're right about that.
I mean, I guess, but yeah, it seems like, in that case, it does seem like fairly... It's like he wants to feel this thing one last time. He nearly made it. And like it gives a very... In this case, it does give a strong sense of the expiration of his life. Although you're right, Croak is the only one that it's like, he was consumed by flames. Okay, that guy's dead.
Lord Croak has the flammable special rule, so you know he's dead.
Right. Yes. He's a mummy frog.
Yeah.
So, Vince, your audio... actually bubbled while you were trying to explain the text there, but so I'll read it again. And that is the enigmatic Lord Croak felt his ancient pupil expire upon the stairs.
Oh, okay. Yeah. There you go, then. Sorry, I missed that. Yeah.
So I'm gonna cross that dude off the list.
No,
possible route.
I will
unless
say
of course in a gas mine.
Sure. I will say what's his name? Oxytocin, Oxycontin. The cheater, the super chameleon skink, that guy's probably alive. If he lived 6,000, that is so long. If he lived 6,000 years in the warp, this is nothing. A bunch of meteors, give me a break. Yeah. I mean, that guy is definitely making it out.
He's going to morph his skin tone and texture into a meteorite so that he can ride one of those things.
Absolutely.
That's how he'll survive.
The tsunami's cause.
Yeah. Okay, so our general conclusions from this are that Lustria gets smashed, except for what spaceships manage to escape, and what bubble protectors that Lord Croak puts on there, and the Southlands as well, right? And thus, you would also assume that a huge, vast, several million Skaven also got pummeled into oblivion by that as well. But probably not Thanquol and Skrull with their Verminlord friends. We agree on that?
I would tend to agree with that, yes. I mean, I think what you could easily infer from this is that Clan Pestilence has all but been destroyed, right? I mean, they had they committed, like, more or less the entire clan to this effort. And now, like, they're all here, they're all on the continent, and they're all dead. Only the ones who had personal vermin lords, who seem clearly to be able to skitter leap around the world more or less, you know, at will, would escape, right?
Yeah, agreed. Okay. Well, that's with that epic event and another continent going down. I mean, we had our last continent go down at the end of Cain, and now Lustria has gone down as well. So another big epic event. So before we close out this chapter, fellas, is there any key things that you wanna point out or talk about before we wrap this chapter up?
I had one small thing. So this chapter, you know, reading it originally, and I'll stay free of future territory here in the story, but rereading it now, as at the point of where I am in, you know, my personal reading, this chapter comes off as weird to me. You mentioned Mazdamundi going through when he does walk between worlds to, you know, ghost himself up to the temple, right? And he hears the laughter. I have to, like, in my mind, reading that a second time, that was the chaos gods laughing at him because what he was doing was pointless. And what I mean by that is there are two possible outcomes right now in the world. Like, we know because we're about to go to the battle for Midheim, and so we're about to see Archaon, like, launch his, you know, bring his host forth, right? That's our next chapter we're literally about to go to. And his plan is to conquer the world, right? To enshrine the whole world into chaos, right? To drive forth and murder and slaughter anyone who stands in the way of chaos and have an endless chaos reign. But at the same time, if Mazdamundi had just, and that's the end sort of state that he's aiming for, and it doesn't seem at this point in the story like there's anyone who's really going to stand in Archaon's way, right? And if Mazdamundi had just let this happen, had just said, you know what, that's it, my people got away, you know, we put everything we could into spaceships, we sent it off into space, who did he save here, right? Like, I almost feel like the Chaos Gods were laughing because they knew you're damned if you do and you're damned if you don't. Like, we've got you dead to rights. I've got my boy about ready to sack you and kill you slow. This was your only chance to die fast. And you just stopped that. I have to think that in the end, the Chaos Gods would be pretty okay with either outcome. Like, do they really care? Do they need the world shaped in one particular way? They're just looking for, you know, chaos and obliteration. So that was what sort of I read out of that. It seems as though, like, the entire, and moreover, it makes me wonder, what was the plan? What were the Skaven thinking in blowing up the moon? Like, in that none of them thought this stuff could rain down and blow up the whole world, because that was what was going to happen. So it almost seems as though, like, there you clearly get even Zinchtail and all of those were clearly just being puppeted by the long chain up to Chaos, right? Because again, Chaos wins either way. It's like Alien versus Predator. No matter who wins, we lose. It's that kind of thing.
Well, let's not give the Skaven more credit than they deserve. Like, sure, they came up with the scheme of a way to blow up the moon, but the motivation for that initially was just, that thing's full of warpstone. We love warpstone. Let's get more warpstone. Just like the kid in the candy store, if you say take whatever you want, that kid takes whatever he wants. You know, there's sure. No end to it. Not thinking for a second about what the consequences of eating 7 tons of candy is.
Yeah, I think that's probably true. And it's sort of a strange setup. But one would think that the Vermin Lords have a bit more foresight and intelligence. And none of them were ever like, hey, don't do that. Don't blow up the moon. That's going to be bad for us. Like, that's not going to work. Because, like I said, they have this sort of protective nature toward the Skaven, right? They clearly seem to care about the Skaven. And yet, they let this plan go off and made no move to stop it. And openly referenced that they know about it. And so I have to wonder, what was their end game here, right? Like, that's what I'm thinking at this point in the story when I read it.
So I think at that point, that kind of wraps up the epic chapter 4, where many great things have happened, good and bad for the Lizardmen and for the Skaven, I suppose. But we will then stop right there, and we'll resume again with the next chapter, because we got a couple more to go in Thanquol. So join us again for more of the end times.